Matthew 19:22-26, the word of God says, when the young man heard this, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. And Jesus said to his disciples, truly I say to you, only with difficulty, or the King James says, will hardly or hardly ever will a rich person enter the kingdom of God, in the kingdom of heaven. Hardly ever, or with great difficulty, or it's nearly impossible that a rich man will enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, I tell you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. When the disciples heard this, they were greatly astonished, saying amongst themselves, who then can be saved? But Jesus looked at them and said, with man this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. Amen. Don't fret. Don't fear. Don't worry. Don't be freaked out. It might be impossible with man. It might be a very hard thing for man to do. But let me tell you something. With God, all things are possible. Amen.
Amen.
I want to look at that statement, hardly ever, because there are two schools of thought, two types of people. If I had a glass of water here, which I don't, and I had a half full, I had a half full glass of water, and how would you describe that glass of water as a, no doubt, been exposed to this very popular philosophical test of the mindset of mankind. You look at that half a glass of water as a glass half full or a glass half empty. It depends on how you look at it. And so you no doubt been exposed to this. Is the glass half empty or is it half full? How do you see it? See, mankind is made up of two types of thinkers. There's the optimistic and there's the pessimistic. The optimistic man sees the glass of water and says, it's half full. And the pessimistic says, it's half empty. Both answers are technically correct. The revealing portion into your psyche is, how do you see that glass of water? It's important that you understand, how do you see life? How do you look at circumstances that you face? How do you see answers or possible options to get you in or out of trouble? How we process life, things in life, goes a long way toward where we will end up. If something good happens to an optimist, they'll say happily, I knew that would happen. It's awesome. But the pessimist says, I'm certain that won't happen again. We got lucky. We dodged a bullet. You've heard them. The optimist lives in a state of hope. Hope for a future. Hope for good things. Hope for change and help in time of need. I'm the eternal optimist. I'm the horrible optimist. I'm the optimist that everybody drives everybody crazy. The whole world could be falling down around me. My church could be falling apart. We could have had a Sunday night service with one person. And my pastor will call me, how are things going? I'm going to say, great, God's moving. It's tough.
Amen. Amen.
I see on your report you had one person last night. What are you trying to say? Yeah, it's just a moment. Just a glimpse. Sorry, it's a moment in time. It doesn't mean anything. It's not, the big picture's still there. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
That's how I am. I mean, literally. I used to be a Phoenix Suns fan until they stopped learning how to play basketball. And so I used to care a lot about them. And my son and I used to go. That was our thing. We'd go to a lot of games. And I can remember, I mean, there'd be 8 seconds left. We'd be down by 10 points. And I'm still waiting for that 8 seconds. I'm still like, we can still do this. We can do this. We can win this! I refuse to leave. My son said, come on, give it up, Dad. No! We can win. We can do this. The eternal optimist. The optimist that lives in a state of hope, sometimes helpless hope. Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
Consider this in relation to our opening illustration. Explorers had to be optimistic in their outlook. Otherwise, they would never venture out to do any of the things. Listen, if you're not an optimist, you're not going to go to Zambia. You're not going to leave an explosive revival in Everett, Washington like I did. We moved from 13 people to 135 people in that church in a year and a half. We were having explosive revival. We were having young people come in by the droves. There was, it was amazing. Our average age was probably 22 in the whole church. And to pay for it all, we had the chief accountant for the city of Seattle. That was a regular church attender. Came on Sunday mornings only and put in $500 every single Sunday morning. What a blessing. Everything was perfect. And then God calls me to Africa. He calls me to leave that church right in the middle of what was happening and go to Africa. And I'm going to tell you, if you're not an optimist, you're not going to go to Africa. You don't speak the language. You don't know anything about the people. You're not sure what's going on. You're just feeling like God's calling you to go somewhere. See, explorers had to be optimistic in their outlook. Otherwise, they would have never ventured out to do any of the things they achieved over the centuries. Imagine if Columbus had not sought a route to India from Europe. The discovery of the New World would be at stake. Or if Captain James Cook had decided it was too dangerous to sail south and thought it better to stay in the English Channel. The discoveries of Australia and later on Alaska and the Hawaiian Islands were the prizes from the hope in the mind of that great explorer. Much of what we see and do in this world are because explorers had the optimism to go out, to leave their homes, to go into the unknown and know that they could get it done. The pessimist, however, lives in a constant state of denial. Nothing good will ever come out of anything in life. They insist on the philosophy we're all doomed, the government is corrupt, all politicians are corrupt, all politicians are liars, they're all liars. The food is poisonous, the sky is falling, this type of life. Life has to be gluten-free, it has to be gluten-free! Is that gluten-free? Is that GMO? What? Is that gluten-free? Is that gluten-free? I was standing in an airport, and you know, I'm always ready at any moment to have fun with somebody. I what some would call an extreme mocker, I like to just be called, I'm just having fun with people. I'm a people watcher, I like to have fun. And one lady came in and she was all worried and on her face, and she walked in and I'm standing there against the wall. I guess I dressed kind of nice, and so she thought I was the manager of the restaurant in the airport. And she came over, she goes, "Is this gluten-free?" I said, "Indeed, it is. All of our gluten is free." She said, No, is this food gluten-free? I said, "We will not charge you for any gluten here, I promise you." She said, No. What I'm trying to say is the food gluten-free? I said, "Absolutely, it's free gluten. You're not going to pay any extra for the gluten." And she's about ready, she's about ready to jump me. And I said, "And I don't work here." I just the sky is falling! It has to be gluten-free! If it's not gluten-free, I'm not... I don't know what I'm going to do. What are you going to do if you're starving and it's not gluten-free? What are you going to do? Yeah, see, that's one of those standards that you really don't really hold to. You only hold to because it's convenient, because you're in a rich country like America, and you can have first world problems like this. Come on, somebody. You know, the fact of the matter is, if you're in Africa, you don't even know what gluten is. You don't care. Is it food? Right. Yes, it's food. Serve me, please. Thank you. Because I haven't eaten in 3 days. That's what the attitude like is in Africa. Yeah. That's a whole different sermon. Okay, so, Proverbs 22, verse 13. The sluggard says, "There's a lion outside. I shall be killed in the streets. I can't leave my house because it's too dangerous." This is a pessimist. Life is too hard. Life never works out. Life never this, never that. See, this is a classic example of how the pessimist mind works, the pessimistic mind works. It conjures thoughts of doom and gloom. It can't see past the obstacles. It struggles so badly with what's in the way of what they want that they never go after what they want. That it's impossible to get what they want because the obstacles in front of what they want are too great. They're too there. And there are people that see beyond the obstacles and see the goal. And there are other people that see only the obstacles. And so the goal is just not worth it. Which one are you? Because if we're going to win the world, we better be the first. We better be able to see a goal beyond the obstacles. Amen.
Amen.
When God told Abraham that he was going to have a son through Sarah, his 90-year-old wife, Sarah had a bit of a pessimistic reaction, as would any 90-year-old in here. Guess what, God says? Guess what, honey? You're going to have a baby. I'm 90. We haven't slept together in 23 years. I know it's a dismal outlook. Genesis 18, verse 10 through 12. The Lord said, "I will surely return to you about this time next year, and Sarah, your wife, will have a son." Sarah was listening at the tent door behind him. Now, Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in years, as if you need to add those words to it. The way of women had ceased to be with Sarah. That means she was already well past menopause, like 30 years ago. It's like she can't, you know you're old and you can't remember menopause. It's been too long ago. Why do you think menopause starts with men? Why do you think that?
Because it's really irritating. It's always our fault.
So, the way of I noticed when I went to make my menopause lighthearted, none of you ladies were into that at all. In fact, some of you looked at me like you had darts in your eyes. Others, yeah, they lifted up your phone with 911 on it. I'm calling. Right? I'm going to press this button if you don't shut up. Now, Abraham and Sarah were old, advancing years, the way of women that ceased to be with Sarah, verse 12. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying, after I'm worn out, and my Lord is old, that's her husband, not, is old, shall I have pleasure? She's laughing. Now, who can fault her for laughing? I'm not even there when I'm laughing. Anytime a 90-year-old woman who's told, you're going to have a baby.
Yeah.
You're either going to get something thrown at you, or there's going to be laughter. God forbid we should ever be caught in such a way. In the King James Version of our text, Jesus uses this term hardly ever. As in, the rich man shall hardly ever enter into the kingdom. Now, a pessimist will read that and change the term from hardly ever to never. It's impossible. Ain't going to happen. The boy is not going to get saved. Whereas the optimist will say hardly ever means there's still a chance, right? Hardly ever. There's still something going on there. There's still a chance. There's a possibility, however remote, it can still happen. When one of the converts from our Parramatta church in Sydney, Australia, Abraham Alfred, a Pakistani, was taken to Christmas Island Detention Center. He was told by an immigration officer that there was a 99.99% certainty that he would be deported back to Pakistan. Abraham's response was, and I quote, I believe in a God who can work with a 0.01% that is left. 18 months later, he was returned to Australia and given a permanent residency visa. Listen to me, how many know that we serve a God that deals in the 0.01% of life? Come on, somebody. They are God. It's incredible. It hardly ever means there's still a chance. Something going on. We got this.
Thank you, Jesus.
This is what hope in Jesus Christ can do for you.
That's right.
You're not out till you're out, and then you might not be out. Lazarus was out 4 days. He was out in the tomb. He was out, yet he still wasn't out.
That's right.
Jesus went, Lazarus, come forth. And something in that tomb, one of the ladies screamed out, but surely he stinks already. That would be my concern at the grave, I think. But something stirred inside there. And you know the story. Lazarus came walking out. Amen. See, with God, you can believe beyond the odds that all things are possible when God is involved. Amen. Mark 9, verse 22 and 23, and this is dealing with an epileptic that has massive seizures. And I'll start with verse 22, and it has often cast him into the fire. Talking about the seizure has cast him into the fire and into water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, he's talking to Jesus Christ. He said, but if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. And Jesus said to him, if you can, all things are possible for one who believes. Now, I don't know whether when Jesus says, if you can, if he's talking about, you know, if you can believe, then all things are possible. Or if he was saying, if you can, because he's responding maybe back to the last statement, but if you can do anything, and Jesus is like, if you can, because, see, I'm a mocker at heart, so that's kind of where I was. If I can, is that what you're saying? Of course I can. Right? I mean, this is the spirit here. If you can, all things are possible to those who believe. And in our text, Matthew 19, verse 26, but Jesus looked at them and said, with man this is impossible. True. But with God all things are possible. See, it wasn't that the rich man of our text couldn't get saved. It was simply that there were great obstacles in his way. Mindsets. cultural and spiritual. He had entanglements that he had to have a revelation about. It's not that your family members can't get saved or won't get saved. It's that there's obstacles. That there's things annoying. It's not that that heroin addict can't get saved. It's not that that absolutely disastrous case that you're thinking about in your life and you witness to it, just saying it's impossible, this guy's never going to get saved. It's not that it's impossible. It's just that there are obstacles. There are things in their way that make it harder for them to come to the revelation about the things of God. Jesus proceeded to give the answer to the disciples about this, how this man might be saved, even though it was in a cryptic manner. He's talking about entering the kingdom of God humbly. If this man is willing to humble himself, there's something that needs to happen. And if this thing would happen, then rich man could indeed get saved. The problem is it's hard for rich men to do this thing. Because of technology, you and I, we see a generation that is filming and recording itself doing ridiculous things. Right? Doing ridiculous things and then posting them on the internet to claim instant fame. This has helped to raise up individuals who are brash, cocky, willing to do insane epic stunts, full of pride. Here's some examples. There was a Russian teenager taking photos of each other on a skyscraper, standing out on the edge of the beams, protruding into the air, and the girl was in such a pose, taking a selfie, when a strong gust of wind blew her off and she plummeted to her death. Then there's the selfie phenomenon where finding the perfect, dangerous, or coolest place to take a selfie to post on Instagram or Snapchat is the thing. From taking a picture of yourself riding a motorcycle moments before your bike and you go off a cliff around a curve, which did happen. They show they have a picture on his phone of him snapping a picture of him in his helmet, riding his motorcycle, right seconds before he kept going straight because he was taking a selfie, but the road was curving. The road was doing something completely different than it was supposed to do. It was supposed to allow him to take his selfie and continue going straight, but the road was curving, so we blame the road. We have to tear that thing down because there can't be no victims in America. We've got to tear that thing down and start over. But the fact of the matter is that he went right off the edge. And then there's a selfie on a bridge, which you then fall off, to falling into the Grand Canyon by leaning over the edge to, you guessed it, take a selfie. Look, Mom, no hands. Crash. And there's a particular thing that happened when my wife and I and my kids were on the Victoria Falls Bridge, which is 350 feet high above the Zambezi River, which is ripping and roaring down below. And so we were there when this husband took his daughter, his five-year-old daughter, and sat her up on the railing. Said, I'm going to take a picture. He walked over here like this, and he turned around to take a picture, and she was gone. She had fallen right over the edge. They never found her again. All for a selfie, for a picture, for a photo. This is going to make a great Snapchat pic. Proverbs 16:18 says, pride goes before destruction and an arrogant spirit before a fall. Many people, young people today, are finding that to be true. They think that fame and success is just around the corner, or just the next YouTube video or Facebook post. But worldly pride only leads to destruction. Leviticus 26:19, and I will break the pride of your power, and I will make your heavens like iron and your earth like bronze. Pride creates barriers. Pride hardens hearts. Pride creates environments that are hard to break through. Pride stands in the way of what you need to do for God. See, this was the problem for the rich young ruler in our text. He had developed a dependency on his wealth. He was a rich young ruler. That was his name. That's how they identified him in the Word of God. It gave him status. It gave him security. It gave him self-approval. It gave him pride. Everybody looked at him. Every girl wanted to be with him. And now Jesus is telling him that in order for him to enter the kingdom of God, he had to give up his possessions. Not because he had to give up his possessions. He did, because his possessions had become his God. See, that's the difference. See, this is still the problem today. People build wealth, buy huge properties, flashy cars, boats, clothes, jewelry, bling, gadgets. None of these things are wrong in and of themselves. But when they become all that you live for, when they become your God, when they become something that stops you from even coming to Christ or raising your walk to the next level in God, then you know that there's a problem. It becomes an idol. Idolatry is in the things you love and block you from the things of God. That's what idolatry is. Anything that stands in the way of you serving God. Amen. And so if this money becomes your God, and that's more important than God, which was true for the rich young ruler, because God said, you know what you need to do? You need to sell all your possessions, give it to the poor. Come and follow me, and I'll make you rich in heaven, because your whole life is bound into these possessions. That is all there is to you. And even though you're a good kid, and even though you've done the commandments since you were a kid, you lack one thing, and that is you're not serving the God of heaven, you're serving the God of mammon, you're serving the God of wealth. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 and 16, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh, the desires of the eyes, and the pride of life, the pride of possession, is not from the Father, but it's from the world. Amen. And I know, I've been guilty. I've taken a picture of my pickup truck. And they were driving me around in these little vehicles in Australia, which I felt were rather feminine. I felt it my duty as an American to pull out my phone and show them what a real truck looks like. That's what I drive around in. I said, in fact, every American has one of these. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh, the desire of the eyes, and the pride of possessions. I remember one time I was in Arizona. I'm going to tell this story. It's never been told before. I'm pulling out of my car. And I'm pulling out, and I look over, and it was early morning. I was on my way to prayer, and my house, which I had just purchased, looked better than normal. It's just, I mean, just the way the light was on it, just the sun and the roof, and we were just putting a swimming pool in the back. And so I pull out, I drive by, and I'm looking like this. And I just keep looking at my house, and it just looks so awesome. And I look at my house like, yeah, that's a really nice house, really nice house. But my car is curving towards the side. And I turned back to go my way, and I slammed on the brakes inches from hitting a parked car because I was admiring my house. God spoke to me about this. Oh, that's on video. Yes. I'm still not used to that. Anyway, that happened to my friend. And so, amen. Proverbs 11, verse 2 says, when pride comes, then comes disgrace, but with the humble is wisdom. God began to speak to me about, you know what, if this house becomes so important that you got to wreck into a car by looking at it, then we got to do something about this. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. To enter into the kingdom of God, we must humble ourselves. Humility is the key. To enter in, we must lay our burden at the cross, and we must bow our knee to Jesus Christ. This is the picture that Jesus is describing in our text. Matthew 19, verse 24. Again, I tell you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. Again, the optimist we'll see the word easier and remark that there is a possibility, there's still a chance, no matter how slim, it's possible. It's easier but not impossible, because Jesus is referring to something that actually could happen. Consider this. In Manners and Customs of the Bible, J.G. Wood says the following of this reference in our text. In Oriental cities, there are in the large gates small and very low apertures called needle's eyes. These entrances are too narrow for a camel to pass through them in an ordinary manner, or even if loaded. When a laden camel or an overloaded or loaded camel has to pass through one of these entrances, it kneels down, it has its load removed from its back, and then it's shuffled through on its knees with its head bowed. So that camel literally must go through the eye of the needle like this. On its knees, the load of the world removed, bowed his head, and go like this. In order to get through the eye of the needle. Now, if that's not a picture of humility, it's not a picture of us falling to our knees and lowering our head before the God that we serve. Come on, somebody. Yeah. If that's not a picture of people that are humbling themselves, take the load of the world off of us, amen, and go through, amen, bowed down before the Lord. The picture of a camel kneeling, removing his load, is the picture of Jesus he's painting for his disciples, of the humility that is needed. For the rich to enter the kingdom of God, he must first get unloaded possessions. He must bow his knee before the Lord. He must lower his head. Amen. And get rid of that haughty pride. He must lower his head and shuffle himself through the eye of the needle. If a rich man is going to get there, he's going to have to do it this way.
Amen. Come on.
See, it's not totally unheard of. Obviously, this is written because there are times in history that camels have had to go through the eye of the needle, and this is how it must be done. What a greater picture than that. Yeah, first we have to unload your possessions. Come on.
Uh-huh.
Amen. You can't take it with you. Huh?
Amen.
You can't take it with you. We've all heard the stories. People that want to take it with them. You know, one man, he said, look, I've got $100,000. He goes, I've given $10,000 to the church. He goes, I'm going to take $90,000 with me. Who knows what the afterlife is going to be like? I need 90 grand. I want to take it with me. And so you're my three best friends. And so I'm giving you $30,000 each. And I want you to put it in my casket during the open coffin time so that they can lock it in there and I can have it with me in the afterlife. So the first guy went up. And he's got $30,000. And right before he puts it in the coffin, he takes $10,000 aside and puts it in his pocket. And he throws $20,000 in there so nobody will ever notice. And he walks away. The second one walks up there. And without anybody looking, he takes out $20,000, puts it in his pocket, throws $10,000 in the coffin. The third guy had been practicing this for a while. And he walked up to the coffin in one smooth move. He socked up all the cash that was laying there from the others and kept his cash and threw a check for $90,000. But you can't take it with you. Amen. If they humble themselves, they can make it in. If they respond to the conviction of God, then it is possible. They have many possessions that will wrap them up. Listen, it's not totally unheard of. Jesus is saying it will take humility. Amen. They have many possessions that will trap them up. But if they humble themselves, if they respond to God, then it is possible. See, God is able to save any and all who would come to him. But it will take humility on the part of that person. Amen. So I want to close with this thought. Encouragement in the possibilities. Amen. And I've got an entire sermon. I'm not going to get into that today. But whatever happened to the rich young ruler, where I follow his life through, amen, beyond this encounter with what we know. And it's a powerful thought. In 1970, NASA attempted its third lunar landing with the Apollo 13 mission. Many of you have heard of this. They made a movie about this story. But due to a rupture in one of the main oxygen tanks, the landing on the moon part of the mission was canceled. The oxygen was not only used for life support, but also to help enrich the fuel, so it burned more intensely. This caused a greater problem because oxygen helped provide power to critical systems through generators linked to the engines. The rocket was 2.5 days away from Earth, or more than 200,000 miles. Three men, James Lovell, John Swigert, and Fred Hayes, were on that flight. They would need all the help that they could get from Mission Control. But the only way that they could communicate with Mission Control was through a radio. And these men had to work through their problems. They had to trust the commands that were given to them from Houston by their Mission Control. And there was no time to argue. There was no time to have a difference in philosophies. They had to listen. They had to pay attention. In the same manner, Christians need to navigate the journey of life here on earth. Amen. We need to trust the commands that are given to us from our Mission Controller. Amen. Jesus Christ. And we need to work through our problems together. Our goal is to get to heaven safely. We need to get there, but we need to pay attention. We need to listen. We need to be encouraged by the words that are spoken to us through Jesus Christ in the Word of God. And for that reason, we need to be listening to what Jesus has to say. Jesus tells us, tells the disciples that God can do this. It may be impossible for you and for me, but God can do this. And a man who believes God can see what God can do and can see God move. The Bible is full of encouragement and full of instances where men who believed God were able to see God move. There's Jonathan and his armor bearer in 1 Samuel 14. He seizes a moment of faith and an opportunity. He says, come, let us go over to the Philistines garrison that's on the other side. See what God's going to do. It may be that God will be with us. He'll work for us. And nothing is holding the Lord back. It's possible that God can do a miracle. Let's just see what God can do. He's talking to his armor bearer. He said, come on, let's have revival. Let's see what God, I feel like God wants to do something amazing. The armor bearer in the beginning was probably like, it's impossible. There's no possible way. You see how many of them there are. There's two of us. But God delivers his purpose in his timing, and a great victory is won. He was encouraged by what he heard from the camp, and in turn, he encouraged his armor bearer, who believed with him, the Bible says. See, belief, vision, encouragement can be contagious.
Amen.
We can catch it from God, and others can catch it from us. If you will be excited for God, if you will be an optimist, if you will lay hold of God, if you will pronounce his promises, if you will shout that God can do this, if you will be a person that stands and says, and others will come to hold.
Yes.
All we need is one person just believe. Anybody in here believe? Nothing restrains. Nothing prevents. All things are possible with God. How many remember when Peter got out of the boat because he believed Jesus was walking on the water and he wanted to play too? See, faith grew in Peter's heart. And he believed it was Jesus on the water. And this moved him to believe that it was possible for him to walk on the water as well. In fact, my Apple iPad has a good illustration of that. When I'm writing this sermon, I write them on my computer, and then I pull it into my iPad, and I set it up there. And there was this sentence I wrote, it is possible for him to walk on the water. That's what I wrote. The iPad had automatically highlighted the word walk. Because walk to the iPad didn't make sense in the sense of walking on water. And so you put your highlight over the word walk and it says you might consider revising this word. Because the iPad has no faith to believe that Peter can walk on the water. Come on, somebody. And so it gave me another word. You could put the word go in the water. But, you know, walk isn't working for us. And listening to the guy, the CEO of Apple, I can see why. And when God, Matthew 14:29, gave him permission to come on. He said, come on in, the water's fine. And so Peter actually, I don't know if you would do this, but there's waves, there's water, they're on the city. Yeah. This isn't your swimming pool, this is your backyard. You know how little floaties are. This is an ocean. It's a Sea of Galilee. It's an inland lake, which has a vast amount of storms. And so he's on the water, and he steps out over this boat, and he begins to walk towards Jesus. Now, we always make fun of Peter because he sunk. But how many of you would get out of that boat and walk on water?
That's right.
Even try it. Even think it would be possible. Even, keep rubbing your eyes because you're looking at Jesus walking on water and you're not believing what you're seeing. There's got to be a jet ski over there. I don't see it, but there's got to be something happening. And so Peter gets out and he walks on water, and we always make fun because he sinks, and we always say, he lost his faith, he's a man of doubt, But the reality is the Bible says that Jesus put his hand out to him, and Peter grabbed his hand, and they went back to the boat together. How do you think they got back to the boat together? You think Jesus dove in and began to do the lifeguard swim back to the boat with Peter and John? No, they walked back to the boat out from the boat. They walked back to the boat. I'm going to tell you something. There's something powerful when we would just believe God. And you're thinking, it's unlikely. But is it possible with God? I mean, is there a hint of possibility? Of course there is. When Jesus told the man whose son was demon-possessed in Mark 9 that all things are possible for those who believe, this was pertaining to the spiritual realm, that God is able to deliver, to resurrect, to restore lives miraculously.
That's right.
In our text in Matthew 19, Jesus is instructing the disciples to believe that God can also save the impossible people. Do you know any impossible people? Anybody here know any impossible people? That Jesus can save even the impossible people. Look to the person next to you and just simply say, you were impossible once. I mean, I always wondered when I first got married, if my wife wasn't looking over at me in the morning and saying, he's still here, he's still here. He's still living, he's still saved, he's still living for God. We get another day. I don't know. Jesus is instructing his disciples that it is possible. Even impossible people can get saved. Linked to God moving to deliver that young boy in Mark 9. Was our efforts of praying and fasting for deliverance. The same can be said of seeing someone saved. We need to pray and fast as our part to see someone who is in difficulties, who is a difficult case, who is having a very rough time coming to believe God, who's an atheist and a loudmouth. Come on, you've met them. That it's possible for them to get saved. The friend who says there is no God. The work colleague who just likes to use the name Jesus as a swear word. People who mock God. People who call you a fool or an idiot for believing those fairy tales in the Bible. People who just laugh and make fun of you. People who are pursuing money, and that's the most important thing in their life. All these might seem as an impossibility to be saved. You might think it's impossible that they're ever going to come to Christ. And Jesus is saying, no, this is possible with God. So in closing, these two incidences, one our text in Matthew 19 and Mark chapter 9, we can be encouraged that all things are possible with God. Never say never. See, God can save the worst of sinners. Just ask the Apostle Paul, who killed Christians for a living.
That's right. Yep.
And God reached out to him, knocked him off his... right off his... struck him blind for 3 days and then sent somebody to heal him. Why? Because that's the kind of stuff the Apostle Paul needed. Come on.
Amen.
He was the original rich young ruler, by the way. See, God can defeat the enemies of Christ. God can raise the dead, heal the sick, provide what we need in life. God can build his church here and absolutely bring a sounding revival to New Philadelphia. How many believe that God can do that? Never say never. God is a revival. It's a church. God can save those. They can work with God. to touch people with the gospel, to raise up a church that can touch people with the gospel, that can plant other churches. Come on, we can raise people up. We can ordain them. We can launch them into the harvest fields right here from this very place.
Jesus.
Amen. We can plant missionaries into other countries. I know. I was one. I went. It's possible. We can have impact in this day, in this age, in this time.
Yes.
Until Jesus returns, we can make a difference.
That's right.
How do I know that? Because all things are possible
Amen.
With God.
Amen. Amen.
All things are possible with God. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know how difficult your life has been. I know that right now there are some things staring at me in my life that seem impossible. They seem very difficult. It's struggling. And I know that this message this morning is about, it might be impossible with you. It might be, not be possible, and even in your mind to conceive that there's a way out, but it is possible with God. So I would take that weight, amen. I would take that heavy, burdened weight, amen, of your life, and I would take it in your hands, and I would give it to Jesus, amen. Hallelujah. I would cast your cares on Him because He cares for you.
Amen.
Thank you.
He's
able to make it work for you. Let's bow our heads. Hallelujah. Close our eyes for just a moment. Nobody looking around. Spirit of God is moving in this place. Jesus Christ loves you. He died on the cross for your sins. He paid the price so that you wouldn't have to. He took upon Himself everything that was meant for you so that you would spend eternity with Him. Jesus, even as the rich young ruler is walking away, Bible says that Jesus looked upon him and loved him.
Jesus.
There was a compassion. There was a love. There was a deep connection. It was almost one of those things like the rich young ruler's walking away sorrowfully, the Bible says. Jesus looking at him and saying, and the Bible says he loved him, cared for him deeply. It's almost like he's rooting for him. He's hoping, come on, turn around, turn around, turn around. Come on, turn around. Come on, you can do this. Come on. We can make this work. Come on. I believe Jesus is doing the same thing here this morning. He's crying out to hearts that are not saved, that are not born again, that are not right with God. He's crying out to you this morning. See, come on, you can do this. The Bible says, and it says it this way, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come into him and I'll sup with him and he with me. I will make covenant with him. I will break bread with him. I will come inside. I will be his Savior. I will be his Lord, and he shall be my people. That's his promise. It's actually a promise for the New Testament in Christ, the new covenant of his blood and the Lord. That's what it actually means there. I will come in, I'll sup with you. We know that Jacob and Laban broke bread as a signing of a covenant. We know that on the road to Emmaus, those men break bread. And the moment they broke bread, their eyes were open and they were able to see that it was Jesus that was with them. There's something about breaking bread that seals a covenant before the Lord. That's what this is talking about. If you're not saved, if you're not born again, if you're not right with God, this is the greatest single opportunity perhaps you'll ever get. Why do I say that? Because you can't promise me that when you leave this place, you will ever be this lucid, this understanding. You'll ever have this much clarity in your mind and heart as you do right now. That this might be the moment that God is calling out to you to give your life to Him, and you might never get another opportunity like this again. While we're here, Let's make it count. Let's give our hearts to the Lord. Let's become born again. The Bible says, unless a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Later on in the same chapter, unless a man is born again, he cannot enter the kingdom. You must die to your old life and be born again in the resurrection power of Jesus Christ and his blood and become a new creature. That's what's necessary. So if you're not saved, if you're not born again, if you're not right with God, then you're in danger of when you pass away and go to hell and spending eternity in the absence of God. Which I can't think of anything scarier. I can't even go a moment in the absence of God in my life here. I've got to feel his presence. I've got to feel his spirit. I get grieved when I feel like he's far from me. So I ask you this morning, are you saved? Are you born again? Are you right with God? Because he paid that price for you. He made it happen so that you could be made whole. So I'm asking you, if you're not saved, if you're not born again, and you'd like to give your life to Jesus, I wonder if you just lift up your hand so I can see it. Every head's bowed. Every eye is closed. This is just between you and the Lord. You just lift up your hand so I can see it. Put your hand up, Pastor. Pray for me. I'm not saved. I'm not born again. I'm not right with God. And you just put your hand up so I can see it quickly. Anybody at all over this place. Maybe you're backslidden away from God. You were saved at one time, but you know what? You're not living for God now. The world got a hold of you again, and you know you're not right. You know that you're not right. It's not rocket science. You know that your heart is not right when you're not living for him. See, if your life hasn't changed, then perhaps your heart is not right. But you can get it right this morning. So if that's you, you lift up your hand, Pastor, pray for me. I want to give my life to Jesus. I'm backslidden. I want to rededicate my heart to him right now. You lift up your hand quickly. Anybody at all? Yes, God sees that hand. Anybody at all? Anybody join us on this talk? Come on, right now. Backslidden away from God, not saved, not right with God. Join us on this talk. The heart of courage that broke the ice and lifted his hand. You can now feel comfortable. Lift up your hand. Pastor, pray for me. I want to get saved. I want to get my heart right. Lift up your hand quickly. Before we go any further. Yes, young man, you see that hand. Anybody else? Anybody else? All right, amen. If you raised your hand, would you do me a favor? Would you look up at me? Did you mean that? I believe you did. Would you get out of your seat? Come up here so we can pray with you. Just come on up here. We're not going to make you do anything. We certainly would not embarrass you. Amen. If I could have Ben come and pray with him. What a great moment. I love this like a child in the Lord every single time. Like a child, like a brand. I just love this. If I can just have one person saved every time I pull an altar call, the rest of my week is just fine, just beautiful, just wonderful. Nothing else matters. It's just like, yeah, how many people do you have? I don't know, we have one saved. Oh, it's fine. That's what matters, isn't it? Anybody else want to join this on song? You can have your seat and you come. But listen, church, we struggle with humility. We struggle with priorities. We struggle with faith. We struggle with areas of priority. We struggle with these things on a regular basis. We sometimes forget what really matters. Like me driving by my house and looking at that. How silly, ridiculous was that? I even prayed, God, take that house from me if this is going to be a problem. Come on. Who cares? Now, I've got houses, I've got stuff, but I've got nothing that I couldn't replace. In fact, I've got a couple things I'd love to replace. So... But the reality is that we cannot allow anything to get in our way of our walk with God. You know what? If you're working too many hours to ever get to church, I mean, if you're going 3-4 weeks and you're like, well, I couldn't come, I've just been working a lot. You know what? Then there's a problem with that job. Because there's 168 hours in a week. You're telling me you can't find two to come to church? That leaves 166 hours. Do the math. If you're from Dover, this is easy. 166 hours left. And if you come to three services a week, that's another 4 hours off. That gives you 162 hours still to do your own thing. That's almost obscene. We should feel backslidden if we're using 162 hours for us and six for God. Come on. We should feel backslidden. You see, God's trying to deal with something here. God's trying to touch you. He's trying to do something in your life. He wants you to raise your walk to the next level this morning right here. This altar's open. Come and find a place to pray. Let's lay hold of God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Let's stand as we're going to sing before the Lord in our best acapella voice. And this altar's open. There's priorities. There's issues. There's things we're dealing with. There's humility. There's things of the world. Many of you, your electronics are causing you to sin. Never before in the history of the world has pornography.